Hello, everybody, and welcome to another APSAD Insight webinar. My name's Jim Hunt. I'm one of the nurse educators here, and hopefully we're going to have a good presentation for you today. Certainly, I think it's going to be a useful one for clinicians to be aware of. Before I begin, I'd like to acknowledge the traditional custodians and owners of the land on which we're meeting and presenting today. I'd like to pay my respects to elders past, present and future, and I'd like to extend that welcome and respect to any Aboriginal or Torres Strait Islanders that might be joining us in webinar land today. So welcome and thank you. Today we're joined by a couple of people. We've got Dr. Peter Kelly, who's going to do the presentation. Peter is Chair of Smart Recovery Australia and is a clinical psychologist and associate professor working out of University of Wollongong. And we're also going to be joined at the end of this presentation by Dr. Angela Argent, who's the National Program Manager and Trainer at Smart Recovery Australia. And I think Smart Recovery is something that I wasn't massively familiar to. I'm probably embarrassed to admit to that, but I think I'm probably not the only one. So I think it's going to be useful for many people to learn about this. So without any further ado, I'm going to hand over to Dr. Peter Kelly, who's going to talk to us about Smart Recovery and give us a summary of the research associated with it. So over to you, Peter.
So yeah, my name's Pete. I'm from the University of Wollongong, and I've got the pleasure of talking about smart recovery and research that's been conducting. It's been focused on smart recovery, both research focused here in Australia, but also internationally focused research around smart recovery. Think of it more of a sort of a helicopter view of smart recovery. So we'll sort of provide an introduction into what it's about and what it looks like. And I'll do my best to provide an overview of research in the area and how that's looking and how that's developed over the years, but very much helicopter review. If you want more details, like absolutely us, make comments and we can answer questions at the end. Or likewise, really happy to send through papers or any further information to anyone if that's helpful. In terms of the agenda for today, my goal was really to begin with just providing an overview around mutual aid groups more broadly, and then to narrow down into smart recovery and talk about the evidence for smart recovery. And then towards the end of the presentation, focus on a study that we've recently just finished. It's been focused on developing an app for smart recovery called Smart Track. So we'll get there towards the end. So as an introduction to mutual aid, I think it stands out that mutual aid is an important part of recovery. It's one of the original forms of drug and alcohol treatment available, extremely long standing. The most well recognized examples of mutual aid are things like 12-step programs, so Alcoholics Anonymous, Narcotics Anonymous. I presume most people on this webinar or watching this webinar right now are familiar with AA and NA. And likewise, I think most people throughout the world are familiar with these approaches. It's really infiltrated its way into popular culture, so television and movies, and it's often what's promoted through legal justice systems, particularly over in the United States. So 12-step programs have absolutely sort of dominated the landscape. I'll talk a little bit about the evidence in a couple of slides' time. But just based on the sheer number of people that access these programs and talk positively about them. And I think the experiences of clinicians having seen our clients go through different 12-step programs can talk to the impact that it has on many people's lives. In saying that, I think one of the things that really stands out in drug and alcohol treatment is this need to tailor interventions or provide people with choice. Unfortunately, we're not at a stage in drug and alcohol treatment where we have the sort of one size fits all kind of magic solution to drug and alcohol problems. What we know is what works for one person may not necessarily work for someone else. Sometimes people need to try something, give something else a go back to the original thing that they were trying. Often it's a bit of trial and error. And likewise, it comes down to sort of personal choice and personal preference in many ways around treatment approaches. So the reason smart recovery was developed, and if you look back at sort of the early published papers around smart recovery, it was really this idea of providing a choice, providing an alternative to people who an alternative to 12-step approaches. So people could still access mutual aid, could still be supported by other people who were, you know, likewise going through their own recovery journey, but to have it as a different approach to 12-step. In saying that, and I'll probably touch on this a little bit later in the presentation as well, when we do studies and we do, you know, surveys of people who are accessing smart recovery groups, we often find that they likewise access 12-step approaches as well. So they're often accessing them hand in hand, or sometimes they'll go to SMART for a little bit and then they'll go to 12-step for a little bit. So I think for lots of people, they're able to make the different approaches work and kind of seamlessly fit together. So I wouldn't necessarily think of them as sort of two exclusively different things, or they do have different approaches. This slide is by far, it's not a great summary of all of the evidence around mutual aid, but just wanted to highlight that there is some empirical support for mutual aid within the literature. For example, you know, John Kelly recently published Cochrane Systematic Review, where in the conclusions, one of the conclusions drawn was there is high quality evidence that manualized Alcoholics Anonymous or 12-step facilitation interventions are more effective than other established treatments such as CBT for increasing abstinence. So that's one example of the evidence that's talking to the high quality evidence that has developed over 12-step programs over the years. Likewise, if you look at things like NICE guidelines, which are, I guess they provide international advice to you know, treatment community around, you know, best practice interventions and how clinicians should approach different disorders. In terms of drug and alcohol treatment, you know, promoting things like Alcoholics Anonymous or Smart Recovery is included as part of those guidelines. And likewise, the Pathways project that was conducted by the group down at Turning Point also in their conclusions found that mutual aid was quite important and encourage that and promote that for clinicians to use that as part of a referral pathway. So I'm not going to be able to do this slide justice. It's probably a presentation or a couple of presentations in itself. But I guess the question is, why does mutual aid work? What is it about mutual aid? What are the mechanisms of action that actually make a difference? And there's probably a number of different reasons. My reading of the literature is the social aspect, the connection, the support that people get from experiencing, you know, this treatment or this support with other people who are going through similar experiences or have previously gone through similar experiences is really incredibly, I guess, powerful and helpful for people. So I think a social aspect is quite important. There's absolutely a behavioral aspect to it. So people developing really practical coping skills. And that's the case both in 12-step, but also smart recovery as well. Developing skills, which often come from their peers and other people who are involved in it, that they can take out into the world and use on whatever their own recovery journey looks like. And then likewise, there's a cognitive aspect. So there's a sense that accessing mutual aid can help improve, you know, people's self-efficacy and belief in themselves. Likewise, it can help improve their motivation and, you know, potentially help them develop some skills to be able to cognitively challenge high-risk situations and events that they might be experiencing outside of meetings. So once again, not a comprehensive review of the literature. Here's a copy of articles that you may want to go and have a look at that are referenced in the last couple of slides. So for now, shift focus to really focusing on smart recovery for the rest of this presentation. So smart recovery is a form of mutual aid. It's available quite widely here in Australia. And Smart Recovery and Smart Recovery International have some really nice websites that provide some descriptions of how the program works. So I thought I might borrow one of the presentations. So here's Dan that works for Smart Recovery in Queensland, and he's going to provide just a really short introduction to how smart recovery works.
SMART stands for Self-Management and Recovery Training and is a free group program assisting people to make any change around problematic behaviours, including addiction to drugs, alcohol, cigarettes, gambling, food, you name it. Guided by a trained facilitator, Participants come to help themselves and help each other using a variety of cognitive behavioural therapy and motivational tools and techniques. SMART works within a four-point programme. Number one, building and maintaining motivation. Number two, coping with cravings and urges. Number three, problem solving. And number four, lifestyle balance. Their weekly meetings, normally 90 minutes in duration, and the focus is on understanding and changing behaviour and not necessarily identifying addiction as a disease. The main aim really is about goal setting and setting your own achievable plan for the week ahead. The meeting format starts with a check-in and exploring what brought you to SMART and what areas you'd like to discuss. The work time is a discussion time where participants unpack the agenda items and set some goals for the coming week. And finally, the checkout, which is about cementing your plan and reflecting on what you got most out of the meeting. We hope you enjoy the meetings.
So yeah, there's a really quick introduction to what SMART Recovery Groups look like and what's involved. As I said at the start, we've got Ange from SMART Recovery. So if you do want some more details as part of this presentation on how the SMART groups work, she can absolutely provide that at the end. SMART Recovery was developed in the US and it's grown. There's over sort of 3,500 groups pre-COVID that have been delivered throughout the world. So if you have a look at the map and in particular sort of pay focus to the orange and the yellow countries, the large majority of SMART groups are run in the United States, Australia and the UK. So that's where the biggest concentration of groups are. But it is provided at over 23 countries and is continuing to expand. You might have picked it up in Dan's video, but there are some key differences between SMART Recovery and other mutual aid such as 12 steps. So it's delivered by a trained facilitator. It's really based on what the originators of SMART Recovery wanted to include were evidence-based treatments, or what was considered evidence-based treatment in the literature at the time. So things like motivational interviewing is a core part, goal setting, cognitive behavioral therapy, using between session activities are really at the core of the SMART Recovery Group program. It'd be remiss to give this presentation to not reflect on COVID-19. So my apologies, I think I was actually meant to deliver this presentation back in March, and then everything started to change. And there have been really large impacts of COVID-19 on SMART Recovery throughout the world. So pre-pandemic, so before COVID-19, online SMART Recovery groups absolutely existed. They just didn't exist in large numbers. So over in the US, there was about 40 groups. And in the UK and Australia, there was about sort of five or six groups in each of those regions. And then when COVID hit and we all went through that period where we all sort of started working from home, all sort of 3,500 international groups had to stop, had to close, and had to think about the local restrictions in terms of how those groups could operate. And that really forced SMART Recovery as an organization to rapidly transition to online groups. And in many places, it's starting to do online groups in countries where that hasn't happened before, and then just dramatically expanding it where online groups did exist. So, for example, over in the US, they went from 40 groups pre-COVID to over 1,200 groups and potentially more now post-COVID. We've recently written, I guess you'd call it a discussion paper, really describing the impact of COVID-19 on SMART Recovery that's currently under review. As part of that process, we met with people who are delivering groups and working for SMART Recovery throughout the world. And the core theme that really came out was the opportunity that moving everything to online is now providing SMART Recovery. And so I think nearly every interview and meeting that we had, people just expressed this desire to continue to provide online SMART Recovery groups well into the future. And there were lots of strengths that people saw to that. So primarily, we're really improving access to people for drug and alcohol treatment. There's lots of barriers in just physically trying to get to an on-site for a meeting. So the idea of being able to access meetings in your hometown online, but also anywhere in the world online, just potentially dramatically improves access. Likewise, confidentiality was another thing that came up really regularly, that online meetings provided greater confidentiality. So people could make up the usernames that might be displayed on the screen. They could choose to put on their camera or choose not to, to put on their camera, et cetera, et cetera. And they can also access meetings outside of their, you know, their local community or their local region. Likewise, online meetings are clearly won't be suitable for lots of people. So some people just won't prefer it in terms of individual choice. There's a whole range of access issues in terms of IT and reliable internet, the IT infrastructure to be able to deliver groups in, you know, different regions around the world. So my sense is that Smart Recovery as an organization will continue to really focus on online delivery and then also try and get back to providing the face, or continue to get back to providing face-to-face groups as hopefully we move out of COVID-19. All right, now let me shift speed a little bit more and try and provide a bit of a discussion around the evidence for Smart Recovery. I think one of the things that really drew me to wanting to do work with Smart Recovery and conduct research in this field was really how some of the early papers around Smart Recovery were written. And these were led by Tom Horvath, who's still really heavily involved in Smart Recovery in the US and internationally. So I think this quote kind of captures it. Smart Recovery will continue to evolve as the scientific findings about addiction treatment and recovery evolve. So I think there was this real sense in that with the founders of Smart Recovery to provide or help develop a program that really reflects evidence-based practice and really reflects the evidence of the time. But I think what's nice is that there's this flexibility and there's a sense that evidence changes over time. And what we think was fantastic 10 years ago, you know, may not necessarily be as fantastic as we initially thought. So the idea that Smart Recovery can kind of grow and change, I think as a researcher is something that I've valued in terms of doing research with Smart Recovery. So if I was to give you an overview of Smart Recovery research, it's basically that they started to try and reflect evidence-based practice, and I think really sensibly picked these different approaches where there was good, strong evidence, you know, CBT, motivational interviewing, et cetera, et cetera. But there really hasn't been a lot of research evaluating Smart Recovery in itself. And so we as a research group have really been thinking about how can we build a program of research around Smart Recovery. So Professor Amanda Baker, who probably most people on the line would be aware of, is based up at the University of Newcastle, and she really led the development of this group of people, our research advisory committee. And I think what she really set out to do was pull together researchers from across Australia who are involved with different academic institutions, really to think about a program of research around Smart Recovery. Well, I can see her face on the screen. I should also give a big thanks to Ali Beck. So Alison Beck has worked both at the University of Newcastle and the University of Wollongong. She's been the project coordinator for a lot of the research that we've conducted with Smart Recovery. And so a lot of the slides have been borrowed from Ali, and she's driven a lot of this work forward. So a huge thanks to Ali. So the research advisory committee established by Amanda, we continue to meet on about a monthly basis. And we had pretty humble beginnings. They were just sort of small cross-sectional survey type studies, really just trying to get a sense of what was happening within Smart Recovery. And then as it's tracked along, we've been fortunate to start to secure some grants and do some more interesting work. So to begin with, really around sort of conducting cross-sectional surveys of Smart Recovery. And I think the major questions that we were interested in for kind of that early work was just describing who attends the Smart Recovery groups, really examining the experience of both the facilitators, so the people that are leading the groups, and the group participants to, you know, see what they value, don't value so much around the groups. And then also just starting to dip our toe into trying to understand some of the mechanisms of the groups. And we'll get to it in a few slides time, but just the idea that, you know, Smart Recovery is based, you know, for example, on CBT approaches. Are participants actually learning CBT skills, and are they using those skills out in the world to support their recovery? They're some of the things that we were interested in to begin with. In more recent times, Smart Recovery have developed an online platform where facilitators who are delivering groups after each group can log in and just include some, you know, really brief information around, you know, did the meeting run on time, how many people accessed the group, what types of problematic behaviours might they have been addressed as part of the group. So my next couple of slides are kind of pulled from sort of multiple different studies and some of that facilitator data, but thought it might be interesting to provide a bit of a description of who attends Smart Recovery. So pre-COVID, there were, I think, over 350 groups that were being delivered across Australia, and I'm pretty sure across each of the Australian states and territories. I think the larger proportions in New South Wales, but they're definitely being provided throughout Australia and likewise New Zealand. On average, about six people attend each of the groups. And when we've previously done some surveys, the people accessing the groups had pretty long-standing alcohol or other drug issues. So they sort of reported 18 years of using the substance of, you know, of choice for them. Of the people that come along to the groups, about 20% of each group are brand new members who are attending that meeting for the first time. They may have had some experiences in attending Smart Recovery meetings somewhere else, but about 20% of group members are new. In terms of gender, a higher proportion of males getting along to the group, and about 60% of them are aged between sort of 35 to 54 years of age. I'll come back to this as a bit of an issue as we go through later on, but there's a really relatively high proportion of people who are experiencing some type of mental health comorbidity who are accessing Smart Recovery groups. So once again, these are just self-report surveys, so I guess take it with a grain of salt, but about 66% of people accessing Smart Recovery have previously attended mental health treatment. About 47% are currently prescribed mental health medication. So if you think about that as a bit of a proxy for who might have a mental health diagnosis, presumably a large proportion of that would be for antidepressant medication. And then when we get someone to complete a K10, which is a measure of symptom distress, about 48% report sort of high to very high levels of symptom distress. Clearly that people accessing Smart Recovery, you know, do experience sort of co-occurring mental health conditions. I suspect there's opportunities for Smart Recovery to potentially be a bit more tailored for delivery within mental health settings as well as drug and alcohol settings. In terms of the behavior of concern, well, I guess just firstly in terms of the colors, so the blue columns are people who are returning to Smart Recovery groups, and the red columns are, you know, brand new people who are accessing groups for the first time. In terms of the primary behavior of concern, you can see that alcohol is the highest, sort of followed by methamphetamines. I think if you look across most sort of standard drug and alcohol services in Australia at the moment, this is kind of a pretty standard pattern. I just might flag the tobacco here. So I'm not quite sure what the percentage of people going to these groups for tobacco is, but it's clearly very low. In saying that, if we ask people who are accessing these groups what proportion smoke, it's up here somewhere. And so it's about sort of 64-65% of people accessing Smart Recovery groups smoke. So although they're not necessarily coming along for smoking, there's some opportunities to potentially address smoking as part of Smart Recovery, as part of Smart Recovery groups. I won't spend too much time on this slide, but we've spent some time asking Smart Recovery facilitators and participants about, you know, aspects of the group that they find most helpful and least helpful. And just going back to kind of the mechanisms of how mutual aid works, you know, 43% of participants are reporting that the group process is the kind of the most important aspect, and then that's followed by kind of the tools and strategies. Similar kind of pattern happening for facilitators, although facilitators put a bit more weight on this, the underlying philosophy of Smart Recovery groups. So I mentioned CBT before, and just kind of the point that we're really interested to see if people accessing the Smart Recovery groups, you know, actually, you know, take in any of the CBT content or are using the content in the real world. So once again, this is a cross-sectional survey. I think it was about 130 odd participants in the study. So, you know, take the results with a grain of salt. But what we did was we got them to complete a questionnaire called the cognitive behavioral therapy skills questionnaire. And it provides a metric of how much they might be using cognitive or behavioral skills within their day-to-day life. I guess what was pleasing to find were that participants were absolutely reporting using a combination of CBT skills out in the real world. And that, once again, cross-sectionally, but the people who were using CBT skills tended to report better functioning, tended to report that they were doing a bit better. Within the, the group process, group cohesion, so the degree to which they kind of felt like their group worked together consistently, so the different members of the group, and establishing between group plans, so this idea of people leaving every group with a plan, something that they want to work on during that week. It's often called the 7-day plan in smart recovery. So group cohesion and the degree to which people had plans when they were leaving their groups predicted the use of CBT skills. So once again, it kind of suggests that there's some things happening within the groups that are influential around the CBT skills. And of course, we need to do some sort of further longitudinal research to see if this does hold up over time. So there's been a systematic review that was conducted of smart recovery, and this was published back in 2017, I think, and it was led by Ali Beck, who we just spoke about before. In terms of the systematic review, it had really two kind of core focuses. So does smart recovery promote positive change in outcome, and what factors influence outcome? In terms of the entry criteria into the systematic review, just from this slide, I would just take away the idea that we were very inclusive. So the studies needed to have some type of quantitative aspect to it. But other than that, we were very inclusive in the studies that we included because we knew going into it that there really wasn't a lot of published research around smart recovery at that stage. So in terms of the findings, 12 studies were ultimately included in the systematic review. And there were really kind of three main studies that looked at, that had some form of control group that was focused on outcome. I'll talk through these very briefly, but I'm happy to kind of help you access these papers if you do want more details around any of them. So the first study, which is based in the community, was conducted by Hester. And there's a couple of publications coming out of this work. So there's a 3-month and a 6-month paper that's focused on it. And so this was the only RCT, randomized controlled trial, that had been conducted looking at smart recovery. And what they were interested in that study was comparing smart recovery participation to an online self-guided website that helped people transition through the recovery process. And the online self-help program was really focused or really consistent on the core aspects of smart recovery. And it's called Overcoming Addictions. So the goal was to compare smart recovery with overcoming addictions with a third group where people got both the overcoming addictions and the smart recovery groups. The quick summary of the results was that across all three conditions, there were positive outcomes in terms of alcohol use. So days abstinent, drinks per day, and consequences were all heading in positive directions for the individual. In terms of differences between the conditions, there just weren't differences between the conditions. And one of the kind of, outcomes or interesting aspects of that study was that the participants really preferred being involved in the smart recovery groups. So they preferred smart recovery and the web-based application rather than just doing the web-based application. Effect sizes for the changes in these variables were quite high and suggest that something positive is happening within the smart recovery groups. This second study was conducted by Brooks and Penn, and it was a relatively small study. So they looked at, I think they ended up analyzing about 70 people, and they were recruiting people who had both a substance dependence disorder and a co-occurring mental health condition. And participants were randomized to either 12-step groups or to smart recovery groups. Results are a little tricky to interpret. So the 12-step intervention was more effective in decreasing alcohol use and increasing social interactions. However, a worsening of medical problems, health status, employment status, and psychiatric hospitalization, so things got worse in those directions. Whereas SMART was more effective in improving health and employment status, but marijuana use was greater for SMART participants. Alcohol use and life satisfaction, were both positive across both of the 12-step or SMART recovery groups. So results are a little mixed and kind of tricky to really get a clear interpretation of it, particularly with sort of quite a small sample size. But I guess the results are suggesting that something positive is happening across both the 12-step and SMART recovery groups. And then the third one was in a correctional facility. This is a study that was conducted by Chris Blatch here in Australia, and it's a really, really interesting study. Huge numbers. So they had over 4,000 people who were within correctional facilities. It wasn't a randomized control trial. They used a match control design. So I think about 2,500 people were involved in a SMART program whilst in the correctional facility, and then there was a max control group of people who didn't complete the SMART recovery program. Results were really particularly encouraging in terms of SMART recovery, in terms of rates of reoffending. So both in terms of general and violent crimes were lower in the SMART recovery treatment groups compared to the match control group. And I think something else that came out of this study, and it's potentially consistent across all of the studies, is this idea of a dose effect. So the more groups that people get along to, the better their outcomes. So in the correctional facility study, they suggested about at least 10 sessions was important in terms of demonstrating better outcomes, which makes a lot of clinical sense. The second part of the systematic review was focused on some of the factors that influence outcomes. And so, as I mentioned, attendance seems important. Self-efficacy appears important. Use of the seven-day plan or homework, doing things in between sessions is important. Potentially group cohesion and the quality of the facilitation might make a difference. I would take all of these with a grain of salt. A lot of it's coming from different studies who are kind of using different research designs or small little cross-sectional studies. But I guess it's pointing some directions towards what some of the mechanisms might be underlying these groups. So in terms of research with SMART recovery, I guess there's a few recommendations. So we absolutely need better controlled studies are needed, and it would be great to get some funding to do some of that research. Likewise, some really well-conducted longitudinal research, I think, has the potential to answer some really interesting questions around how people use mutual aid. And there's some work over in the US happening in that field at the moment, which sounds really exciting. I think there's absolutely an opportunity to also consider mental health as part of research designs and potentially the development of a SMART recovery in the future. Something to note with the systematic review, hasn't been any published research examining SMART recovery for Indigenous people. So if I was to highlight a different systematic review that was conducted by Liz Dale, she recently looked at the use of mutual aid groups for Indigenous people of Australia, New Zealand, Canada, United States, and Hawaii. And there was a very, very small number of studies that were available. I think it was about four studies that had been published. I think they were all focused on an AA within the United States. So there's clearly an area for development. Liz is currently doing a PhD that's focused on examining the cultural appropriateness of SMART recovery for Aboriginal people here in Australia. And so she's recently just completed some great qualitative work where she's been interviewing participants and facilitators who are working with SMART recovery in Aboriginal regions. And likewise, she's recently just completed a Delphi study where she's met and discussed and gone through with Aboriginal experts, Aboriginal health experts, in terms of looking at the culturally appropriateness of SMART recovery and considering ways that it can be adapted. So that work's currently under review and is obviously really important here in Australia and in terms of improving SMART recovery to make sure that it's meeting the needs of our First Nations people. But likewise, I think the designs that Liz is using is potentially useful to be used across other geographical sort of cultural groups throughout the world. All right. So now I just wanted to touch base on really the last study that we've been conducting with, or the most recent study that we've been conducting with Smart Recovery. It's around developing an app that can help to complement Smart Recovery groups and also be used to help evaluate and track how people are going as part of Smart Recovery. So the app's called Smart Track. Oh my, developing an app is a big, complicated job. So a big thanks to lots of partners. So it's a Smart Recovery. The study was funded by New South Wales Health. We were really fortunate to work with an organization called GHO, who are a creative agency in Sydney who focus on the development of things like apps and websites. Really helpful in terms of bringing, a sophisticated design element to something. And likewise, just having an app that's really quite easy and user-friendly for people to use. There was lots of engagement from people attending Smart Recovery groups and facilitators. And likewise, there was a really large research team that was involved in that project. So the goal of Smart Track was, twofold. A, we wanted to develop an app that was just helpful for the people who are accessing Smart Recovery groups. But B, a way to start developing a body of evidence around Smart Recovery that could be used to refine the project, the program, and help improving Smart Recovery. So it was conducted in two stages. The first stage involved really collecting qualitative data that could be used to help inform the development of the app. And that work has been published here. But it was really around meeting with lots of facilitators, meeting with participants, doing interviews and trying to get a sense of what their needs were and what they would prefer as part of the app. People who are accessing Smart Recovery went into the offices of GHO and were able to provide feedback in there as well, which is a really nice part of the design process. And then we conducted a feasibility study, really just to see if people would use it and if it would be helpful. So the app is available and it's at no charge in the Android and the Apple web stores. So this is what it looks like and some of the introductory information. Having completed the study and getting lots of feedback from participants, we realized there are a number of things in the app that needed improving or needed changing. And we're really fortunate that a private benefactor was able to contribute some funds. And so rather than just sort of finishing the study and being stuck with what we developed and stuck with the mistakes we'd made along the way, we were able to go back and update the app and refresh the app. And I think in the next couple of weeks, it should be released to those stores. It's all been completed. We're just waiting on ethics in terms of some modifications to the confidentiality statements in the app. In terms of the app, it goes through and it measures a whole range of health behaviours and goal setting aspects within there. This information isn't all collected at once. So the way that data is collected, it's alternated throughout the process. So people enter data for maybe 5-7 minutes a week of some of the outcome measures. But they also might spend more time on there helping to kind of monitor and observe their recovery journey. As I've said a few times as part of this presentation, a core part of Smart Recovery, at least here in Australia, is leaving each group with a 7-day plan. And so within the app, there's information, there's places where they can go through and put down what their plan might be. They can really kind of clearly specify it. They can link to their calendar. They can also go through and rate how confident that they are to do it. Likewise, they can keep track of how they've gone with achieving their goals as part of the 7-day plan. Likewise, I think there's nothing more disconcerting than disheartening is probably a better word, than filling in lots of outcome measures and just never getting feedback or never knowing what the results look like. So we've tried to, in the app, really provide lots of sort of colourful, easy to read feedback that people can see how they're tracking. So these types of screens that kind of provide an overview of how people are travelling at a particular time. And then there's some more detailed information where it can really track people's scores over time and people can make notes around how they're travelling. Something that came out as part of our interviews in the development of the app And really, I think GEHO really led this, was this idea of people being able to track their urges and being able to log and track their urges in real time. And so that was another function that's been added into the app, which has been really well received. As part of that process, we have some motivational feedback that's provided to participants. But they can also upload their own photos, or upload their own motivational quotes or videos that they might want to put in there as well, in addition to other information that we have in here. So this is a picture of someone's dog. In terms of resources, so there's a whole range of resources built within the app, which is potentially helpful for participants. So there's some readings, there's some lived experience stories based within there, and some links to some other services. So I guess just really quickly, in terms of our feasibility study, we recruited 72 people to be involved in the feasibility study. We found that the app was pretty well used. So about 58% of people use the smart track for at least 5 weeks or more during the study, which we were really quite pleased about. 8 weeks was the length of our study that we were running. In terms of the use of the routine outcome measures, you can see that there's a drop off. So really quite high rates within the first sort of 2 or 3 weeks, and then start sort of tailing off a bit once you get to sort of 6 or 7 or 8 weeks. This isn't unusual. This is typically what happens with apps as people are using them. But I think the challenge for us and for smart recovery is to really think about ways to get people to continue to use these outcome measures. And we really think it's around integrating the app a little bit better into the smart recovery groups is likely to help that. In terms of the qualitative feedback, so really positive qualitative feedback from participants. They tended to appreciate the app and enjoyed using it, found it relatively straightforward to use and beneficial. And likewise, similar feedback from facilitators. They saw it as something that was kind of useful for the people that are accessing their groups, which was encouraging. So in terms of conclusions around the app, I think a real strength of the project, and it really comes back to Ali Beck, who helped to lead this project, was that it was really informed by the end user experience. So it was really informed by the experience of smart recovery participants. It's feasible and acceptable to use. Absolutely, the challenge now is thinking about how we can improve the integration of the app within the groups to try and increase people using it in the longer term. And then, as I said before, we've recently updated the app, and a new version should be available in the stores in the next couple of weeks. The last thing I just wanted to touch on, if you've got an interest in smart recovery research, either just hearing the outcomes of research, or you might be a researcher yourself, you're interested in conducting more sort of mutual aid or smart recovery research. We've recently established the Smart Recovery International Global Research Network. And so it's a network of researchers throughout the world. If you're interested in joining, if you just go to the Smart Recovery International website, here is where you can sign up. It's free. And we'll start to have some sort of regular newsletters and some activities around really encouraging and supporting research throughout smart recovery. So that's all of my time. Thank you so much for listening, and really happy to take some questions.
Thank you very much, Peter. An excellent presentation, really thorough. And lots of questions have come through. Now, before we start the questions, I'll just say again that we've also got Dr. Angela Argent. I hope I'm saying that correct. Apologies if not, Angela. And Angela is the National Program Manager and Trainer for Smart Recovery Australia. So she's also going to unmute and engage with responding to questions as needed. So please continue to keep those questions coming in if there are any. I'll kick off with the start, which may be one more for Angela. I don't know, Peter. Can you describe the group process a little bit, as in how long a group would take, the frequency that it would run for, what an actual engagement in the group would look like for a participant?
Sure.
Yeah, Ange, you want to have a go at that?
Sure. So a typical group meets for 90 minutes. Some groups are shorter in duration than that. Groups with young people would meet probably for an hour, for example. What happens in a group is that the facilitator will kind of unpack the kind of key premise of meeting, that is that everybody's confidences are kept, that everybody's in a safe space, that it's an empowering space for people to share ideas, never advice, so nobody gives advice in a smart meeting. We kind of talk about how it's supposed to be about self-management. So that's the kind of key priority in working with people, that they learn to self-manage. The facilitator will then just get a sense of who's in the room by doing a very brief check-in of about a minute with each participant, just to find out really what's brought them along for the day. The majority of the time is spent in kind of collaborative problem solving, where the whole group will kind of work through one very specific question that a person might come with. For example, like, how do I get my camping gear back from my old ice using buddies without re-engaging with them? So it could be as specific as that. And the group will kind of problem solve a bunch of ideas in that space. The participant would sift through those, choose the thing that's most likely to work for them. And then the final part of the meeting is actually working through a 7-day plan to actually just engage in the baby steps required to go about solving that particular question for that participant. And then at the end of the meeting, the facilitator thanks everybody, asks participants actually what they've gotten from the meeting, you know, what they might have learned from each other, and asks them to actually go through step by step what that 7-day plan will look like for each of them, and then closes the meeting. So it's really just an opportunity to problem solve for everybody involved. Everybody there is treated like an expert by experience. As Pete said at the beginning, all meetings are run by trained facilitators. Some of those facilitators are peers, that is people who've come through the program. And we really love that at SMART, because they're the kind of best evidence of success that the program has. And also a bunch of clinicians also work with us from a range of professional backgrounds too. So lots of meetings are actually run by both a peer and professional facilitator at once. And that's sort of an ideal scenario.
And as a participant at those meetings, do I attend at the start of, you know, a course and proceed for, you know, 10, 12 meetings or whatever it might be? Or is it more like the AA where you can dip in and out as you, you know, feel you need? What's the process for that?
People are welcome to attend any time that's useful to them. Generally, people do tend to come for 10 weeks or 6 months. Some people manage to actually get some traction control in a much shorter period of time than that. Some people will come for a very long time. Like, I've had people in my group in Newtown for a couple of years. But sometimes people just come back to celebrate anniversaries of slowing down or quitting as well. So you might not see somebody for 6 months, and then they'll reemerge just as a kind of like cheer squad, really, for the rest of the group. And it's always fun when
that happens. Yeah, nice. And that obviously leads to another question. Is there, and if there is, what sort of cost is involved to an individual that wanted to engage in a SMART process?
All meetings are absolutely free. There's no cost in attending.
Perfect. And looking at you now, Peter, is that also the same for the app? Is that something that people can access for free? And the other question, just jumping slightly sideways, sorry, just because I raised up about the app, is it something that people can just do the app, or do you have to be engaged in the group? So cost of the app, whether it's free, and whether you can have one as a standalone, or you have to be engaged in both?
Yeah, sure. Yeah, the app's completely free. So they're just available in the web stores. And then, yeah, look, it's been designed to really complement and support SMART recovery groups, but there's no harm in someone downloading it and seeing if it might still be useful for them. So,
perfect. Thank you. I think you probably have kind of answered this reading between the lines, but a question we got asked is, obviously AA is an abstinence-based approach. Do you see SMART recovery as a harm minimization or a harm reduction approach?
Ange's passionate about this topic. I'll pass it on to Ange.
So I guess originally SMART was imported as a way to let people stop when they're ready. In Australia, it's been interpreted quite differently. For us, it's actually about letting people just be as healthy and well as they can be, and to use all of the kind of tools and stuff within the program to enable them to do that. So for us, most people will come along not with the intention of stopping ever. In fact, I don't think I've ever run a group where somebody comes along and says, I just want to stop. Usually what people do is come along and say, you know, I really need to have a conversation about my use with this particular substance. I'm not really sure anymore that it's necessarily doing me some favors. Can I just have that conversation? Some people actually land with abstinence at the end of all of that process because it's just simpler and easier for them. Yeah. But that's certainly not the goal in attending. And it's certainly not something that we expect of people either. For us, just healthy use and traction control in life is what we're all about.
Perfect. Now, you've kind of also hinted at this in one of your other answers, apologies. But question that we got, you've mentioned that in the research, you know, the ages of the people that you were looking at were kind of between 35 and 50. But Angela, you've suggested that there might be a smart for youth. And somebody has also asked, just building on from that, is there a smart for families as well? So if you'd like to respond.
Sure. So, I mean, yes, there are smart groups that are catered particularly for young people. We work through a range of partnerships with other organisations, including Turning Point and a bunch of others. There are a number of groups, particularly online, that are really flourishing in this space at the moment, because young people actually do like to engage in people's social worlds differently. So sometimes some facilitators have said one of the best things about COVID has been young people connecting with each other because they like the look of the posters on each other's walls in the Zoom meeting that they're attending. It's a form of connection that they wouldn't get if they were in a room together, where they might kind of feel estranged and alienated and a bit uncomfortable. There's this kind of acceptance and this kind of accessibility into each other's worlds through being online. So this is one of the huge, I guess, moments of success around COVID that we're kind of delighted by. But there is a kind of flourishing of young, of groups for young people in this space right now, and that's excellent. We do also have a family and friends program. And again, this is kind of flourishing online in ways that we couldn't have anticipated, and we kind of can't train facilitators quickly enough in this space. So if anybody would like to do some training to help out in that space, that'd be fabulous. Because it really is doing the work of meeting the needs of family, particularly at the moment, because there's so much strain just in being kind of stuck at home. And that exacerbates lots of problems for lots of families. So yeah, we have a bunch of online meetings. I think there are about six now, various times and time zones, and accessible and available to anybody.
And I guess building on from that, if the groups are free for people to attend, I'm assuming that the people that are running the group, generally they do that on a volunteer basis. Is that how that would work?
So all of our peers work as volunteers. Yeah. Some of the people will do it as part of their everyday work in their professional work. So I guess they're being paid through their workplace to run groups for us.
Thank you. Another one, sorry to keep going on about the process of the actual group itself, but it seems to be what people were interested in. I really loved one of your phrases, Pete. We often see PDOC, so primary drug of concern, when people are coming through our doors. I really loved PBOC. I like the primary behaviour of concern. That hit a chord with me, so thank you for that. But in the slide where you were talking about that, you were talking about the fact that there was an other group, and also I noticed gambling was there. I'm assuming other would include things like food addiction, sex addiction, whatever that might be. Is there any exclusion for smart recovery in relation to behaviours?
No, there's not. None at all.
Okay, which is a good answer. Much of the program, somebody's asked, much of the program is CBT focused, and we obviously saw some screening tools that you use for some people. Do you screen around cognitive ability and the ability to actually engage in that cognitive behavioral therapy process prior to people joining the group, or do you just work with what you have at the time?
There's no screening pre-attendance. People can just turn up to a meeting for the first time. Nice. What we do is ask that people are not intoxicated while they're attending a group. Yep. But we have people engaged in the group so long as they're kind of lucid enough to actually share words that make sense with each other. Yep. That's really our only requirement.
So I think it's about really just promoting access and, you know, encouraging people to get along and, I think that's sort of the underlying philosophy for SMART.
It's a welcoming space, you know, and it really is perceived as that, I think, by participants.
Difficult question, so I'm interested to see how the answer to this comes. Peter, when it comes to looking at effectiveness of groups, how do you look at what success is when you're doing your research?
That's a tricky question. It's a nightmare question when you are doing drug and alcohol research, often your focus is on something like abstinence, but you just miss so much other important aspects of the person's world. So the short answer is I think we need to do better in terms of how we success in inverted commas. When we're doing those types of studies, I think we need to think really holistically. And I think it's really getting at, what are the person's own goals and what was the reason they were engaging in treatment and what were they hoping to get out of it? I think they're the things that we want to consider. It's just tricky from a research perspective to do all of that. And I think that's often why we just go back to drugs and alcohol as outcomes, yeah, and abstinence, which is a pretty blunt outcome.
For us, I think it's wellness and thriving. So the videos that you saw, Megan's kind of statement that actually she's back in study and that she's re-engaging in a whole bunch of, meaningful activities for her. For us, yeah, that kind of thriving is the only success that quality of life.
I think that's it. Looking at a holistic person. Yeah, definitely. One of the things that was evident in the research was that I think it was 42, I might have that number wrong, percent of people really valued that group process. Do you think with the change onto the media platforms that we're using now, do you see that as potentially changing? Because obviously there's a very different engagement with someone face-to-face than there is over a screen.
Did you want to answer, Pete? Or?
I can take a stab at it and then you might want to add to it. I think they're different, they're potentially different processes. And so I think the group experience is still potentially very important on the online delivery, but I think it's a different experience to what's happening in the room. We're collecting some data about it at the moment, looking at that process, but it's a different aspect. And I guess that's the concern around doing online is, to what extent does it undermine? Just as conversations you have as you're walking into the room or when you're finished and you sort of leave, you tend to miss some of that as part of Zoom meetings. But in saying that, I think there's lots of people who are, accessing smart recovery in Australia, but also around the world who wouldn't have ever accessed if it wasn't available online. So there's kind of pros and cons. Did you want to add anything to that, Anne?
Yeah, no, that's exactly the answer. I think there are benefits and disbenefits of both approaches, but if you're right and this kind of COVID doggy does evaporate at some point in time, it will be delightful when we can be back in the space of doing both, so people can have the choice about how they access their meeting. And it could be that they choose to do both, and that would be great too.
Moving back to the Smart Track app, somebody's asked, is it possible that if somebody's using that particular tool, do they get the ability to share their progress from the tool with the counsellor or therapist during the actual meeting sessions? Does the app become part of that group process?
No, it doesn't. It doesn't become like the facilitator doesn't get access to the data. It's sort of a number of sort of ethical and practical issues to think through something like that. But absolutely, they can sort of talk to their screen, or they could show their facilitator if they wanted to, or they could share the information to whatever extent that they felt comfortable with. But the actual data isn't sort of sucked out and provided to the facilitator or anything like that. Yeah. And maybe in some circumstances that might be okay. In other circumstances, that just really wouldn't make sense.
But certainly participants do sometimes talk about, what their experience of that week using the app has been and whether that's been beneficial, and if so, in what ways within a group meeting.
And you mentioned, Peter, that there isn't much evidence of this being used in Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islanders, but you've got somebody that's working on that at the moment. Have you explored culturally and linguistically diverse groups? Is there any evidence or any use of it in those groups?
So I don't think my understanding, I'm talking outside my head, I don't think that there's a lot of published research around it. It's certainly been translated into different languages and delivered around the world in different languages. And I think that there's been some experiences here in Australia where there's been some translations. I think somewhere like DAMEC might have delivered some of the groups at some stage. Can you add more to that, Ange?
Yeah, there's manuals in a few languages, Vietnamese. I think there's a Spanish manual. There's a few in the world. But I mean, part of the opportunity of kind of working internationally across SMARTS is that we can kind of tailor the program and actually examine what it takes to make it inclusive, appropriate, sensitive, and meet the needs of a range of audiences. So actually working with SMART, and I think it's actually now 25 countries, Pete, it means that we have the opportunity to kind of work with the model in a range of languages and spaces and benefit from that in Australia, for example. So, you know, if Denmark is rewriting a manual, why would we not actually import that manual, have it available here in Australia, and let people run a meeting in Danish if that's what works for them, or Vietnamese or Portuguese or whatever it is. That's kind of our hope in working to collaboratively, that we can kind of milk the resources of all of the smarts out there and benefit from them here locally as well, and also share.
And potentially, I guess, just because of the media platforms now, you know, taking Danish, if that was my first language, I guess there's no reason why, if there was groups happening in Denmark, I could actually access those groups, even though I'm living in Australia, so that the language wasn't an issue.
Absolutely. Yeah. So we're kind of working in that way multiculturally as well into the future.
So I'm just, sorry, I've just been handed another couple of questions, which I'm just going to read out. I apologise. What is the ideal or average length of time to gain the goal people are ideally wanting to reach? Now, there's a question for you. So how long does it take people to reach their goals?
Almost like an existential question.
I think that's a very personal thing.
It's totally a personal thing. I guess reflecting on maybe the correctional study, they were suggesting that people needed to get to at least 10 groups for it to start having an impact in that sort of in that setting. It's an individual perspective.
Yeah,
it really is though, the amount of time that it takes somebody to just take on board those skills, those kind of CBT skills, and use them across a bunch of domains of life. For some people, that's really like 4 or 5 weeks because they're just, the uptake is super quick for them.
Yeah.
For other people, it just takes a bit more time. And it also, you know, depends on what else is going on in their life.
Definitely.
Like, you know, have they got, you know, some semblance of a family to return to that just kind of is an ordering principle? You know, is uni still happening? Are the other kind of domains of life still functional?
Yeah,
it depends really. It's highly specific to the person and just what else is happening in their life.
And the good thing about it is its flexibility to be able to adapt to that, I would assume. So
yeah, very much so.
Cool. I've got one other question and then I'll probably wrap it up because I know time's pressing on and we're holding you back from the rest of your day. So just finally, who does the data that's collected on the app? I assume at some point there might be a use for that in research. Who actually gets access to the treatment outcomes data that's collected? Where does that actually go and who is able to access it? Somebody's asked.
Yeah, that's it's a really good question, a really sensible question to ask. So Smart Recovery retains the data. And then University of Wollongong is the group like where I work, who's currently working on the data in terms of that. I think the key with any app or any kind of data collection is just being really upfront and transparent with whoever's entering the data, that they know exactly what's happening and what it will be used for. And that's where we're currently at the moment. We're just going through ethics to make sure that they're really comfortable with the wording of how data's shared. All of the information that comes to us is de-identified. We don't have anyone's names or anything like that in there. But yeah, I think the key ethical principle is just making sure that the people entering information into whatever the app is, that they know what's happening and they can make their own choice.